There's a phrase motorcyclists love to repeat, like a mantra. All the gear, all the time. As riders try to pressure their brethren into enduring sweat, cost, and inconvenience in the hopes of saving their lives. Or maybe just bits of skin. Many riders choose to go without gear, facing criticism and demonization as squids. Referring, of course, to how the human body squishes on pavement during high-speed impact. Admittedly, motorcycling is an emboldening experience. With all that power and speed between your legs, it's easy to feel invincible. As with smokers, riders delude themselves on statistics. Sure, a certain percentage of riders do crash, but not everyone. Not them. Noise and chrome makes for proud Harley bikers, to look tough in no gear, as though their tenacity could somehow beat concrete. In wearing gear, they're admitting their inadequacy as a rider. By admonishing the fact they might crash, it makes it seem all the more likely to their brethren. Now, a full suit can cost just about as much as a bike, and it's hard for people to make the expense without seeing the utility. A few hundred extra bucks on bike parts gets results immediately, where gear only matters if you crash. When you crash. Even the best motorcyclist in the world can't control what everyone else is doing, or the wildlife for that matter. All it takes is an act of God, a momentary lapse, a stuck throttle, a snapped cable, a slipping tire. So I ask you, what is the value of your life? Well, maybe not just that, but the value of your skin, of your bones and sinew. What is the value of your mind? Even the most basic gear drastically reduces the consequences of a spill, and the cost as well. Surgery is terribly expensive. Fortunately, dirt riders are humbled early. On rugged terrain in mud, through rocks, and over sand, adventurers are introduced to ground early and often. This experience is jovially known as being baptized, as riders are bathed in earth. Through pain, they see the value of gear, and the scars endlessly remind them. But through focusing so much on the value of gear during a crash, we often forget how it can prevent one entirely. Reflective strips and high-vis coloring make other motorists aware of a rider's presence, through the unnatural yellow that blankets road workers. Sure, there is a benefit to high-vis over other color choices, but I'd say it's far more critical that riders don't choose a dark color. Reflective strips on black look like oddities in the night. A bunch of glowy lines, an alien object. Without seeing the outline of a man, our brains don't automatically comprehend that it is a man. Reflective strips line signs, cones, barriers, and so many other things. A second of confusion can make a lot of difference. Perhaps this is a bit speculative, but by simply wearing gear, motorists tend to treat riders with a little more courtesy. Motorcycling is a dangerous thing, and gear expresses an appreciation for this danger, thereby making riders appear less reckless, and principally concerned with traveling safely. If you don't seem to care about your own life, why should anyone else? We tend to think of crashes as isolated incidents. That once we hit the ground, the ride is over and we go home. Or to the hospital. Adventurers are rarely afforded the luxury of a quick escape from remote areas. Given most crashes off-road are fairly minor, but even a minor injury can be deadly out in the middle of nowhere. Twisted ankles can render shifting impossible. Dislocated joints make hand controls inoperable. Bruises make moving troublesome. Every hindrance steals ability, and subsequent crashes become more likely. But there is something to say about pain. Pain has a lasting effect on the nerves long after a crash. Riding in similar circumstance can make you tense up, hesitate. It's a principal form of irony, as the body tries to protect itself by reflexively demanding you stop. It might work for things like climbing trees, avoiding thorn bushes, or snakes. but a moving vehicle doesn't cater to a panicked mind. Truly, the fear of injury makes it difficult to do anything. But injury is by no means limited to crashing, as the environment provides some amount of danger. Sunburns can be just as bad as real burns. Frostbite is often unnoticed as chilled flesh goes numb. Wind chaps skin under loose clothing. The noise of an exhaust can damage hearing after hours and days in the saddle. Stray branches scrape at bare skin. Even the gear itself can injure you over time. The slightest stitch out of place, seam in the padding, or irritating spot can make a ride miserable. Improper fittings mean blisters, sore ears from taking a helmet on and off, and water trapped against skin makes rashes and breeds fungus. Heavy and stiff gear strains the wearer. The world is full of hazards, and adventurers don't always get to choose the conditions in which they ride. They are faced with rain, snow, fog, hail, and dust, everything falling from the sky or kicked up into it. Arid wind saps moisture from the skin, excessive heat taxes their stamina on harsh trails. Cold stiffens flesh, robbing strength and driving shivers. Humidity blinds them, in fog made with each careless breath. Rain presses into everything, pulling it down with added weight. Dust clings to glass and bugs stick to it. Hail feels like an air gun, and hot air makes you think twice about the saying. Which brings us to the point of this episode. The purpose of adventure gear is to keep riders in optimal condition on extended trips when faced with a variety of hazards. Every environment will feature different challenges, and not every trip demands everything be covered. But I will say, as an adventurer, the concern is versatility, ensuring you can meet every plausible condition safely. Admittedly, this is a loose term, as safely does not necessarily mean comfortably. Here in the Rockies, the weather is notoriously unpredictable. Denverites love to joke that you can see all four seasons in a single day. Although much of the world has fairly predictable weather reports, where the temperature doesn't vary significantly from day to day, and the rain either comes not at all in a season or at the same time. And in many places, you can see a storm coming hours in advance. But when you're somewhere far away, and you're somewhere you don't know, you can't always predict the weather. Even so, a small chance is still a chance. On my first adventure, I rode in temperatures ranging from 20 degrees to 100 degrees. I endured rain, lots of rain, and dry wind, cold air, and blinding light. On subsequent adventures, I faced everything I've mentioned previous, and almost always without expecting it. Some of the time I was prepared, other times I was not. So, let's go over gear and what I think is important. For the sake of being concise, a complete set of gear includes a full-faced dual sport helmet to protect the jaw, a jacket and pant made from friction-resistant fabric with padding on the spine, elbow, shoulders, hips, and knees, including a detachable waterproof layer, a pair of gloves designed for use on a motorcycle, and a pair of high-water boots to protect the ankle. In addition, I recommend a water pack, a balaclava, earplugs, thermal base layers, sunglasses, a spare set of goggles, an evaporation vest or collar, and a sweater. When it comes to helmets, they should be plainly colored. Complex designs may be pretty, but they act like camouflage to the human mind, as the whole is broken into pieces. It's much easier to perceive a helmet when it's a solid. Light coloring is highly preferable, as hot sun directly to your cranium is tempting heat stroke. Dual sport helmets have peaks, the visor going off the brim. This component is critical as it prevents direct sunlight from hitting the chin of the helmet, thus throwing off the eye's ability to perceive contrast on the ground. Unfortunately, they tend to catch wind, which strains the neck as your body is forced to resist it. Higher quality helmets place more investment in ensuring their product is aerodynamic, and keep in mind that some stylish design elements make wind a far greater problem. A helmet should never have a tinted face shield. On bright sunny days, they may seem nice, and they can prevent sunburns. But when going in and out of wooded areas, it might as well be night. And every adventurer has at least one experience of getting in far later than they had planned. Night, heavy rain, and even dust can render you blind. Ideally, a helmet should be on the more sealed side of the spectrum. For two reasons. First, it blocks out noise. Second, it blocks out wind and keeps your head insulated in cold conditions. For extra ventilation, it's a lot easier to leave the visor open and wear goggles. Of course, helmets do nothing to protect the chin and neck against cold. Even the nose and ears are prone to frostbite while in a helmet. So, I'd recommend a motorcycle balaclava. These are a little different than other types, as they are extremely thin to fit under the helmet. But the one thing I cannot recommend enough is pinlocks. This adds a hydrophobic material sheet to the inside of the face shield, and water will not collect on it. Remember all those movies where kids fog up the ice cream glass? Well, imagine that in your helmet, because you coughed or even just breathed heavy. Instant whiteout. Ventilation fixes this somewhat, but again, that's cold, and it doesn't work in high humidity. There are over-the-counter hydrophobic creams that serve the same purpose, but these require repeated application. For boots, these need to be high water, in other words, most of the way up the calf, to protect the ankle. It is absurdly easy to sprain your ankle. It's a flimsy thing. In addition, it protects the shin against stray branches, and the calf against hot exhaust. Plus, they provide a gripping surface to aid with standing on the bike. A broken-in pair of boots should not be so stiff that you can't walk a few miles while wearing them, or have tread patterns exclusively for use on the bike. As an adventurer, there might be a day where you have to hike out of a hole. When it comes to socks, I have to say wool, even in warm weather. Cotton gets soaked and gets pointless. Some polyester blends are okay, but only wool retains its ability to provide warmth when wet. At least, pack a spare. Wool is problematic for some, so they come in blends from 10% to 90%, with 25% being the most common. If need be, you can wear nylon socks underneath as a barrier. When we talk about adventure gear, probably the most important thing to discuss is the pants and jacket. Although most riders are afforded access to leather gear, adventurers are limited to fabrics. This is because leather is heavy, designs do not cater to the complexity necessary for use on extended trips. You'll tend to see outfits advertised as four season or summer only. Summer outfits are typically mesh, and it is nice to wear a mesh suit on hot days, but they are useless in rain or anything below the room temperature. Four season really just means cold weather, as these are uncomfortable in anything warmer than room temperature. You could carry both, but this adds a lot of weight and a lot of cost. I find that having a regular jacket and pant can be used in nearly all riding conditions, just not particularly comfortably in extremes of hot or cold. Preferably, they will have three layers. An outer shell, a windproof slash waterproof layer of laminar plastic, and a warming, fluffy inner layer. Keep in mind, heat is lost or gained in three ways. First, through radiation, which is why black makes a poor color choice. Then convection, which is why a breeze can make you feel so cold or hot. And conduction. Insulation protects against conduction, in essence by making multiple air pockets within a material. Heat transfers through contact, and to put it simply, it is a slower process with less dense substances because fewer particles are in contact. By nature, it is a porous material, and so absorbs water from sweat, as well as being fairly pointless in a breeze, since the air within the pockets are replaced with different air. This is why convection is the main concern of the rider. You'll often find that the waterproof layer is warmer than the warming layer, as it is airtight, blocks out direct contact with the wind. Pretty much any jacket or pants can be worn with something underneath, adding to the insulative properties. But a sweatshirt will stiffen joints and feel more bulky than something designed for the jacket. However, base layers are much more flexible, and make a great addition to any adventurer's closet, as they are lightweight and warm. Plus they're cheap, since almost any clothing retailer will sell them. When it comes to coloring, the lighter the color, the better in warm weather. Sure, light colors get dirty, or are simply honest about how dirty they are, but they make sunlight a lot less troublesome, and they don't cost you anything in the shade. In fact, this is the reason I chose a white outfit, with the hopes of extending my gear's utility into warmer temperatures, as well as increasing my visible footprint at night. Not all fabrics are the same, but they do have quite a few similarities. Fabrics require regular treatment with hydrophobic coatings like Scotchgard. This does not make them waterproof, but prevents water from being absorbed in the protective layers, soaking the outfit and making it heavy. Although Gore-Tex is nice, it does have its downsides. Yes, it is waterproof, including a layer of stretched Teflon located underneath several protective layers. The Teflon sheet is porous, with some 9 million pores per square inch. These holes are small enough that liquid water cannot pass through, but not so small as to be airtight. The company which makes Gore-Tex is highly restrictive on how its fabric is used, ensuring designs must have no potential for even the slightest leak at the seams or zippers. Unfortunately, this means that clothing made from material is poorly ventilated, and access to pockets or zippers can be somewhat tedious. You might consider a Gore-Tex jacket if you frequently encounter rain, but keep in mind they are less useful in hot weather. Traditional fabric is far more breathable and tends to have more effective ventilation designs. To aid with cooling, there are a number of evaporative vests and collars on the market. These work by first being soaked in water before a ride, then acting like sweat. They only really work in the wind, and when dry, they unfortunately make things a little worse, as they serve as an insulator. But so long as you keep this in mind, they can be quite helpful. The one really critical thing every jacket needs is a place to put a water pouch, one of those you can drink while riding. This is important, as dry wind saps moisture from the skin, and dehydration has a tendency to sneak up on you. When drinking from other means is inconvenient, you might just let yourself get dehydrated. The downside is that water pouches explode should you ever fall on them. So last on the list is gloves. They need to be intended for use on a motorcycle. This is something you won't realize until the day you find yourself in a crash. Cheap work gloves shred on asphalt and don't have protective padding or sliders at critical areas like the thumb or knuckles. They're designed for work, not contact with pavement. For gloves, I would honestly recommend two pairs. A heavy winter glove, and something lightweight for general use. Waterproof gloves should be gauntlets and cover the wrist to prevent water from moving up the arm. The sad truth about gloves is as they get more insulation, they get harder to use, and fine motions become difficult on the bike. Ultimately, this means in cold weather, where the rest of your body might be comfortable, your fingers will be cold with almost any type of glove, even with hand shields and grip warmers. A little tip for helping with cold weather for all types of gloves is by wearing medical gloves underneath. This helps with convection, as wind will not directly contact the skin. I would recommend that waterproof gloves be made out of Gore-Tex rather than leather because, again, leather is very stiff and restrictive. Gore-Tex is far more flexible. Gear should do the best, always, to try to not get in the way of the rider. And finally, if possible, waterproof gloves should have some sort of squeegee or some other equipment to clear droplets from the face shield. And once you have the gear, you might look like an adventurer. And I'd say it's very important to have the right tools. But that isn't what makes a person an adventurer. So I guess we still have a lot to talk about.